Hi, it's Searching for Answers again, and we're still searching, and we invite you to search along with us. Sometimes we think we have more questions than answers, but that's okay. This is your chance to grab your Bible and get with us, whatever translation, language, version works for you. You can consult the text as we go and stay right with us. Our discussants this evening are Dr. Bernard Taylor, Old Testament scholar, most recently the pastoral staff of Loma Linda University Church, and Dr. Bill Johnson, New Testament scholar, known to many as editor-in-chief of the Adventist Review for many years. We're glad you're available to help us think about Hebrews, because this book has had a special place in your life, hasn't it?
Yeah.
Pastor Beverly Maravilla on the pastoral staff of the La Sierra University Church and Family Ministries. We're glad that she can join us as well here. And Dr. Leo Ranselin, New Testament scholar and member of the faculty of the School of Religion, the associate dean of that distinguished institution. We're glad you're with us. My name is John Jones. I'm with the Divinity School at La Sierra University, and we'll get right into the text. We were talking last time, you may recall, about chapter 3 in Hebrews, that opening paragraph which compares Jesus with Moses now. We've seen him compared with angels in chapter 2, compared with Moses now, and what they have in common is the category of priesthood. Ah, but there's more to the story. Mm-hmm. As we go into chapter 3, beginning with verse 7, we have the a quotation from Psalm 95, which is such a familiar psalm to us. We use it to open up our worship services. And if you want to keep your thumb in Hebrews and flip back for a moment to Psalm 95, you will immediately recognize the opening verses. Oh, come, let us sing to the Lord. Make a joyful noise to the rock of our salvation. Come into his presence with thanksgiving and so forth. Mm-hmm. We use it all the time, mm-hmm. don't we, in our calls to worship. But there's an interesting phenomenon about this psalm. Right in the middle, we stop quoting it in our calls to worship. Because right in the middle of the middle verse, verse 7, the clouds began to gather on the horizon. Isn't it so? Mm. Oh, that you would pay attention and listen. Beverly, take us through that painful second half of the psalm that we have here in chapter 3 of Hebrews, if you will.
Sure thing. So, as the Holy Spirit says, today, if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts as you did in the rebellion during the time of testing in the desert, where your fathers tested and tried me, and for 40 years saw what I did. That is why I was angry with that generation, and I said, their hearts are always going astray, and they have not known my ways. So I declared an oath in my anger, they shall never enter my rest.
Ouch. That bites. What does this refer back to, Bernard? What's echoing in the background here behind this?
Rebellion in the wilderness. Mm-hmm. Rebellion in the wilderness. On the journey from Exodus, from Egypt to the Promised Land, often called, referred to as the Exodus. And an ongoing experience so that the first generation almost completely never entered. Caleb and Joshua were the exceptions, and the time period was much longer than it needed to be because it was decided that they had disqualified themselves, and it was a matter of funeral after funeral and the countdown until that was completed.
Our viewers who are following along in the King James Version, in the last verse there, right at the end, when God is angry and swears, in the King James, it translates rather literally, word for word, if they ever enter into my rest, and it stops right there. That's a kind of a formula, isn't
yes.
it?
Yes, yes.
You want to help us with that one a little bit?
Yes. In the Old Testament, you have the technical term is the protasis, the if part of a conditional, and the apotheosis is the then part, And the then was often expressed. Now, one of my teachers suggested perhaps it was a motion with the hand or something like that, but the penalty was unstated. I didn't need to go back that far when I was a kid. You'll get it. You don't know what it is, but come this evening, we'll settle the score. It will happen, and it's pending, but you know it's not going to be good news. It's like small print and fast talk on television. It's never good news.
Well said. So it's sort of like, if I hear one more word out of you, and the rest is left.
Yes.
Right.
Bill, what do we make of this painful passage?
Well, it is, I find a lot of interesting things, but the way in which the writer understands scripture, notice how he introduces the passage. Therefore, as the Holy Spirit says, it is originally addressed to the people of God way, way back. Mm-hmm. But now it's as though he leaps over the centuries and the Spirit is speaking directly and he quotes this scripture. It's a very interesting view of the Old Testament, which we find throughout this book. Very, very high view of inspiration. So regardless of who is the writer, it's always God speaking. In this case, the Holy Spirit speaking.
Yeah, he knows good and well this is Psalm 95, but but that's not the point. It's the Spirit.
That's right.
And when we look at the Talmud, where the rabbis kind of debate with one another, we often see them quoting scripture in such a way. They'll say, well, as it says in a certain place, they know where the place is. Or as the Spirit reminds us. So you're right. I think this comes out of a particularly exalted understanding of who is really speaking, not the prophet, but someone behind the prophet.
And just a quick footnote to that, as we go on, David will be specifically mentioned. So this reinforces, this is his view, this is God speaking, but David is the writer and he identifies it as such in the next chapter.
Leo, this book really draws upon the Old Testament again and again, doesn't it?
Absolutely. It kind of continues, to me, in an implicit way, to highlight the inadequacy of Moses, right? Mm-hmm. Yes, he was a faithful servant and witness of the things of what is to come in the future. And yet Moses is the one who led the Exodus generation out of Egypt, right? And they're the ones who fell in the wilderness, right? And just a long list here. Their hearts were hardened. There was a rebellion. They always go astray in their heart. They've not known my ways. Yeah. It's quite a sketch of this rebellious generation, the Exodus generation that Moses led out of Egypt. And so for me, I'm struck by, here we are again in another warning passage, right? Mm-hmm. We had an earlier one in chapter 2, verses 1 through 4, and there, hey folks, we need to pay attention lest we drift away, right? So he was concerned about drifting, now he's concerned that the community of believers may start to act in the same manner that this Exodus generation did. Mm-hmm. And so I wrestle with how much of this do I understand in an analogous way? Is there a risk of their hearts being hardened? Is there a risk of them going astray? And we're going to get to this in verse 12 and following. Is there a risk of them having an evil heart of unbelief, of being taken captive by the deceitfulness of sin? I mean, he really goes after the issues here. And so is this what's happening in his community? Is it this dangerous that we need this kind of a strident and strong warning of the Exodus generation in which he says, watch out, folks. You may fall in line just with these folks, just like they did.
It's a strong warning.
Mm-hmm. And one last thing,
the original words are very strong indeed.
And I'm sure Dr. Johnson will get at this. To me, here's the first hint of the pilgrimage motif, of the journey motif, right? They were journeying to the promised land, and we too, likewise, with our confession, with our calling, are journeying to the heavenly city. And I think he wants to, seems to me, draw an analogy with that, doesn't he? Mm.
Well, the stakes are pretty high.
Mm. Right.
This is serious stuff.
They started out well.
Yeah.
And God manifested his power among them. But nevertheless, you know, they fell by the way, and God was, quoting, angry with them.
Mm.
And they will never make it, God says to them. This is strong stuff. It's a strong passage.
The last word is rest.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
These people are not going to enter into my rest.
Mm-hmm.
Which already resonates for us with the idea of God's entering into his rest.
Right.
The last of at the end of creation week.
Mm-hmm.
Here we see another kind of signal that we're going to get into pretty soon, don't we? Yeah, the whole idea of the sabbatical rest that is still waiting. And by virtue of the fact that no one's entered in with God into that. So, there are a number of motifs that are starting to cut across each other here. This is thought-provoking and provocative stuff.
Mm. Mm. It is, yeah. I was actually thinking of that very word rest and how it ends with this, you know, the psalm itself, as you read the first part, was first a celebration of sorts, you know, rejoice and lift your voice out, you know, out loud.
Right.
And, you know, it's this grand celebration. So this really is quite jolting at the end to say, but actually there's going to be a stop to this and you will not rest, right? Mm. I think for the community, as we had talked about with their the commitment to not just the, I guess I would say that the Jewish practice, but how meaningful it was to fall into a time of rest.
Mm.
And so now it's withholding this one thing that even maybe beyond what other chaos they might have experienced, this one thing.
Mm.
You're withholding this one thing. You know, I'm thinking of how this plays a role in, you know, we've kind of mentioned this idea of parenting, right? And how is it sometimes that we discipline our children, we withhold that one thing that brings them joy? And I'm wondering, this is quite fascinating for us to be just at that moment of rest. He's also identifying that the chaos that they are feeling is quite exhausting. Aren't we tired yet?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Aren't we done with this? Haven't we been tired with generations of the same practice, of the same? And so you shall never enter my rest.
Mm-hmm.
It's quite daunting, you know, to think of will we always be tired this way? And so it makes me think of today, something's gonna be also draining us, right? Something, what is bringing us exhaustion? And feeling that same, you know, almost at the end of the week being able to get into our Sabbath rest, and can you imagine not being able to find that peace, but bulldozing then again into more chaos or more exhaustion, right? So, I'm hoping that it will mimic some of the other patterns where there's a pastoral move of, but I am with you, and this is the God that has not left you. I'm hoping that's coming, because I'm going, whoa, okay, you have our attention. Now are you going to love us through this?
Yeah. Well, I think that's lurking. It's coming.
Yeah.
But it is. We can imagine, can't we? Dragging through the desert.
Mm.
Children, old people.
Yeah.
And this song. Back here, Psalm 95,
mm-hmm.
among the Jewish people was known as a Sabbath psalm,
mm-hmm.
a psalm for Sabbath worship. And it starts off well enough, doesn't it?
Mm-hmm.
But they're not getting there.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So that's another telling kind of connection, it seems to me. There are several psalms that are identified as Sabbath psalms, especially. So here we are. Anything else before we move on?
Yeah, if I may.
Please.
First off, verse 7, this is another therefore.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And second, what is to be done? If you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts.
Yeah.
What does it mean to harden the heart? Now, we're a couple of weeks removed from Valentine's Day, as of recording. And when we think of heart, we think of love. What you may not know is that in biblical times, Old and New Testament, heart was the seat of both emotion and cognition. And, you know, there was, they didn't associate headaches with thinking, they didn't know that there was a brain or anything like that. And so here is a call to accountability and responsibility. And reading that into the context of Hebrews leads me to wonder whether these people are, well, there was the drift, there's the slide. It's not open rebellion, it's not just at least, and may not even be that, but it's the failure to live in the present, to find the rest and to stay there and to be in communication with God. So these people may need the strong language to help them realize what it is that is the danger ahead of them.
John, two things.
Please.
Back on this word rest.
Yeah.
As we work through the rest of this chapter and into the next one, you'll find this word will come up many times.
Right.
But it undergoes a shift in its significance. Mm-hmm. Here, it seems to me, in terms of Israel in the wilderness, what's the rest they're looking for? It's Canaan.
Right. You know.
Cross Jordan into Canaan's land, okay? And so that generation, their hearts are hardened, they rebel, and they don't make it. A couple make it, but the, as a whole, they don't make it. But we'll see later, it shifts from Canaan to something else.
Right.
So that's one word. The other word that really strikes me is a word that will occur at least two more times in this chapter and the next. And that is the word today.
Mm-hmm.
He'll play on that word today. So what is today? What is today? Some commentators, I think, have expressed it well. God's eternal now.
Yeah.
Today. It's always today when God speaks to us.
So, yeah, the idea that Christ has taken this role of high priest is kind of a messianic claim in a way. Mm. So that means this new age, this new era, the call, the summons to enter into his rest is heightened.
Yes.
And made more urgent and immediate. At the same time, when we recognize that this is a sermon, it's being presented, read, preached to the assembled worshipers, that implies it's the Sabbath day. So you've got a kind of a double referent going on here. This time frame and this seventh day of the week today. Intersecting in that one word. Isn't that interesting? So there's a lot going on here, isn't there?
And there's a fresh proclamation of God's voice, of God's message, of God's word, that I think is, to be Wesleyan and Arminian here, is an appeal to the wills of the people, their freedom. And you see again and again this notion, if we hold fast, right? So it's important for us to understand, it seems to me, persevering faith, faithfulness involves this appeal to the act of their wills, that they hang on to their confession, no matter what. Irrespective of the sufferings and hardships they may be going through, perhaps similar to what they went through, in which they too might be tempted to unbelief and perhaps apostasy. Please don't do that. Hang on to your confession today.
Here's where faith and faithfulness begin to take your
segment. Absolutely.
Right. So we'll see more of that.
Could I relate a little experience here?
Please.
Make it short. When I was doing my doctoral work at Vanderbilt University, as you did, same university, the person who was teaching Greek had emergency surgery. So the dean asked, would you take over the class? Which I did for a while. Vanderbilt, you know, has some very bright students. Many of the people taking Greek were not only divinity students, they were undergraduate students. And I happened to mention that I was writing a dissertation on Hebrews. A bunch of them came to me at the close. they were very much concerned about Hebrews mm-hmm. because Hebrews teaches so clearly that you can accept Jesus, become a Christian, and yet lose it all. Mm-hmm. And these students were from a tradition and a teaching where once you accept Jesus, you've got it made.
Exactly.
You can't fall away. And so they were really earnest, you know. What do you think about Hebrews? Does it really teach this? I said, absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. You can start well, but you can lose it all.
Right. And we're going to actually wrestle with a challenging passage in chapter 6 where the author seems to suggest that once you've tasted of the good news of the gospel and apostatize and fall away, there's no longer an opportunity for repentance again.
Yeah.
But which again gets back to your point of human freedom
yeah.
and the decisions that we need to make when we hear God's voice today.
Yeah.
Mm. Sure. Yeah. That theme, that chapter 6, if we had to lose part of the New Testament, I would vote for that.
It's
James even.
It's maybe the toughest passage in the whole Bible.
Yeah.
6:4-6.
Yes.
Yeah.
Very. But we'll get there. And we'll
the amazing thing about this book of Hebrews, the strongest words of assurance, full of absolute confidence in Christ.
Right.
But alongside that, the most dire warnings of losing it all.
Right.
Or both, you know, in between the same covers.
Yeah, well, there's a lesson there for us.
Galatians and Romans?
Yeah, right, yeah, that's right. Exactly right. Yeah, so you've got point and counterpoint, don't you? Mm. Bill, take us through the rest of the chapter. Pick up with verse 12. And
I mean to read it?
Yeah, we may not have time to discuss it.
Okay.
But see what we can make of it.
Take care, brothers and sisters, that none of you may have an evil, unbelieving heart that turns away from the living God, but exhort one another every day as long as it is called today. So that none of you may be hardened by the deceitfulness of sin. For we have become partners of Christ if only we hold our first confidence firm to the end. As it is said, today if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts as in the rebellion. Now, who are they who heard and yet were rebellious? Was it not all those who left Egypt under the leadership of Moses? With whom was he angry for 40 years? Was it not those who sinned, whose bodies fell in the wilderness? And to whom did he swear that they would not enter his rest, if not to those who were disobedient? So we see that they were unable to enter because of unbelief.
Mm. Again, the last word, love of faith, unbelief. A series of rhetorical questions. He knows that the hearers know the answer. Verse 16, who were they that heard? Yeah. Was it not they who left Egypt under Moses? With whom was God angry? Against whom did he swear? Yeah, it's a way of give and take, isn't it, with the hearers?
Yeah. But the point is, all these people were privileged. Mm. They'd seen the mighty acts of God.
Right.
But nevertheless, something happened. Okay, the hearts, something happened to their hearts, yeah. So watch out.
Right.
Watch out.
Bernard.
It's heavy stuff. But it's effective. It's going back to Psalm 95, and in that piece, I think the force of it is that it is something they already know. It's not a fresh, it doesn't call for a fresh revelation. It's a realization that it's the same underlying situation that our ancestors faced. They made their decision. It's your choice. Genes are not determinative. Mm-hmm. You have to make your own decision, but you have the freedom to make that decision. You are not bound by what happened in the past. And this is going to continue and open up a vista. First word of the next chapter is another therefore. Mm-hmm. He moves at a measured pace, moves forward and then applies it, moves forward and then applies it. He's building an immensely convincing case. It's compelling, but it is drawing. It's not condemnation, but reality in the life of the past, but more importantly, in the life of light of Jesus, who is better than all of this, and all that they have held dear now has a fulfillment which he wants them to understand and enter into.
Not a word wasted.
Not a word wasted.
Not a word.
Beverly, how do we bring this home to our lives?
I feel like, you know, these are, you know, this paragraph is in a sense, as we've kind of been mentioning, they're rhetorical. You know, this is something that you know, and I also find that there is a sense of this isn't something that necessarily is a evil-spirited as much as it is trying to bring you back. You were mentioning, I think that that's the loving part of Jesus, although it feels as if you might be at the point of losing it all. There's a reminder of almost as if you're recovering the people back to a state of something more. So waiting to see, I'm asking you all these questions because you already know the answers, right? And so maybe for us today, it's let's not get stuck in just what we know, although history is so helpful for us as an entire Christian church, as individuals. So be weary of these questions. Maybe they're ones that we need to constantly ask ourselves. And how are we moving forward? What do we have to look forward to? And maybe sitting in this word, this last word that ends our chapter is unbelief. It's a tricky word, I think. We often don't. We associate only specific things with unbelief, and yet there's so many different ways in which our life can actually speak unbelief in contrary to what we might think we are believers of, right? So, some thinking to do.
So, Leo, we've got really three time frames, don't we? Those ancestors back there.
Right.
The people of the New Testament,
right,
and our time today,
exactly,
being stitched together.
We do have a today where we must listen to God's voice.
Yeah,
right. Absolutely. If I could add one thing to that, Beverly said in verse 13, perhaps the antidote to all these warnings and what the Exodus generation went through is that the community of believers is to, on a regular and continual way, encourage one another, comfort one another, right? Each day. Each day. So faithfulness, I think, also involves being part of a community of believers in which we get strengthened and nourished and comforted by one another as we face the travails of life.
We kind of, as Bev has reminded us, we kind of individualize and personalize that pilgrimage, don't we? But it is a group effort. The picture is one of holding hands together as we advance toward the kingdom, isn't it? And so we'll think some more about these matters as we look at that pilgrimage next time, when we get together again, searching for answers.